first time this year, our first guest tonight, Faraja kutoka Nyalandu. A lot of people know her as Miss Tanzania back in 2004. Lakini pia, they also know her as a businesswoman, as a mother, as a wife, and also as an entrepreneur. She was small, a bit of a small entrepreneur a few years ago, but right now she's one of the biggest entrepreneurs in the country. And she's doing a lot of things to help kids from different places, women, and also men as well, not just women or kids. So we're about to start our interview. Hopefully you'll get inspired and you also connect and be educated after we're done. Karibu sana.
Thank you.
Tell us about Shule Direct.
Okay, Shule Direct is a social enterprise and we leverage technology to be able to create access to quality education. And when you look at technology, technology comes in so many formats. We look at accessible technology, technology that is already in households, people already using it. So it could be mobile phones, it could be laptops, it could be desktops. It could be a radio, it could be a television. The vision is that someday every device that you have in your household or in your hands should be having educational content that is qualified and you can access anytime and anywhere. So eventually we hope that we can leverage every single platform to be able to create access to quality education, be it a mobile phone, be it a smartphone, be it a laptop, be it a desktop or a tablet or any other kind of technology. We would like to grow with times. So if you look at our development as a startup, as a social enterprise, we've really focused on what is in the market now and how do we grow with our market to ensure that we are growing with the trends, we are able to create that access over time and ensure that if there is a new technology coming in or a new device, we'll be able to create access to education through that. And the main goal is really to be able to, through that access, to be able to improve learning outcomes of our learners. So right now we're focusing on secondary school students and really want them to be able to not just access our content, but make something useful out of it. They should be able to learn and improve their pass grades, improve their exams, their continuous assessments, be able to pass their Form 4 exams and progress to higher learning levels. And education isn't really useful if you cannot apply it. And we try to look at different ways that we can ensure what we're providing as a curriculum, even though it's very fixed, but the way we provide our content triggers the thinking process of a student and enables them to be able to apply the learning resources they're getting and to be able to apply the skills they're adapting. Because if you're using an educational platform, let's say a website, the process of using that platform, you're actually gaining some skills, you're gaining some digital literacy. And that also improves your learning, it improves your logic, it improves your problem solving skills, among other things. And so we look at education at different from different faces, and we hope that eventually we'll be able to have a young person who is able to improve their potential and achieve their dreams.
I'm thinking about a couple of things right now. Back in the days when I was studying in secondary school, there were very few means of me acquiring education.
Right.
In class or tuition. So right now there's another option.
Yes.
So you mentioned a couple of things, but when something new is introduced into a community, mm-hmm. it means there was something lacking. Mm. What did you think was missing, or what did you go through, or what idea did you get to formulate Shule Direct?
Yes, that's how I started too. I could only get quality education through a teacher or a textbook or tuition classes. And usually, so there's several things. So looking at it from maybe two perspectives. There's one that's more of an individual. Imagine yourself being in class, and the class session perhaps is only 45 minutes, and you're expected to be able to grasp all the learning content within those 45 minutes. And what happens if you don't? If you don't, it means that you only have to go to a tuition, which you don't know if it's approved, if it's qualified, there's no mechanism to actually have that assurance of the quality. Or you have to get a good textbook. Or you have to get another platform, which now they're here, Shule Direct is here, mm-hmm. which can have those alternative or supplementary learning resources.
Okay.
So that's from the perspective of an individual. You are able to learn independently in a flexible way that previously wasn't really available. And most importantly, you're actually learning local content. Shule Direct is based on local content. We look at what is in demand, what is needed by the society, by the students, by our learners, and try to fill that gap. And looking now at from the perspective of a society, you find that you have teachers who are not qualified, And if they're qualified, they're not really enough. So you have that gap of, let's say in rural areas, from the recent statistics, you have 67% of teachers are missing. Could be from absenteeism or just a lack of good teachers. Or you find that you cannot really have good textbooks in schools, the infrastructure, the environment is not conducive for learning. And in most cases, what you find to be a school is just a place where people go to attend. It's more of an attendance place, more than a learning place. That covers most of the schools in Tanzania, public schools. So, and public schools, unfortunately, cover about 89% of secondary schools in the country. Okay. So you can imagine 89% of students are actually just going to school as a checklist and not really as a place where they can actually learn and develop themselves. So the system where we're existing, the education system has several challenges, but ultimately you also look at how has the government been allocating its budget. Like when you look at issues like teachers' salaries, those are more systemic issues or enough classrooms. But then it affects the entire, it has this trickle-down effect, which ultimately the person who suffers most, the victim, is the student. And I know we all know that we've paid enough of a price to have students who just go to school without learning. When Shule Direct was starting, we were looking at the results had just come out in 2013, the Form 4 results, and we had one of the worst failure rates that year. And it was very clear that there was such a profound problem in our community, because if you fail Form 4, if you fail your O levels, the way our education system and our life is structured, it's almost like you failed. That's it. Yeah. To be able to come out of that, you really have to be either coming from a very good family to be able to provide you with alternatives, or you should be able to perhaps have a natural talent. I call them like membrane kids, those kids who will make it in regardless of anything. Yes, yeah. And yeah, so I think secondary school became such a turning point for our lives, for Tanzanian lives. And so it's really important that people do well. And so the education system overall has to be supportive of that.
You mentioned something really important about most of the schools in the country, the public schools, more than 80%, right?
Yes.
Now, if you think about it that way, now I come to the question about Shule Direct. Yeah. If I were a student back in secondary school, which was many years ago, would I pay? It was a long time ago. Inamaanisha sasa ningekuwa nalipa kusoma vitu kwenye mtandao, but Shule Direct, or is it free? How do I do it?
So we have different platforms. The first platform that we started with was a website, and it's free. It's hosted at shuredirect.co.tz, and it's free. It's a freemium site that we have some features of it that are free and some features which are paying features. Mm-hmm. So we thought of having the what we call a basic education, things that you must learn, things that you need as a student to be able to learn and access as a secondary school student, regardless of your financial situation. So that includes the syllabus and learning notes. So you have learning notes covering 11 subjects based on the national curriculum. And then we have quizzes, which are premium content, which you have to pay for. But it's still very basic. You pay 100 shillings a day or 500 shillings a week.
For the quiz?
For the quizzes. So that's our premium content. And the same amount you can also pay on SMS. So you guys, you all have to subscribe. So you send the word Makini to 15397, which is our short code. It's available on Tigo currently. We're moving to other networks. Okay. And you can subscribe at 100 shillings or 500 shillings a week.
Okay.
And the good thing about Shule Direct, which is not so evident, we thought more of the back end. So in the back end of everything that we're doing, we have an educational content repository where we structured our entire content database and system database. I don't want to go very technical, but we have something called an API, which allows us to put in content and take out content to any platform or application.
Okay.
So for example, the content that lies in our repository is pulled into our website. It's the same content that can be pulled to our SMS platform, to our application, and to our learning management system. So we have two other products. We have an Android app and a learning management system. And it's easy for us to create any platform or any technical developments easily and just pull the content from there, from our repository, because the first 2 years of our enterprise really focus on that content build and system building, the back end, and ensuring that we're able to grow with whatever dynamics that are there in terms of content or in terms of technology. So for instance, maybe we want to have a radio show that does just content, for instance.
Yeah.
It's easy for us to just pull content from there and start a radio show tomorrow. So the content structuring is done. What we're moving on with now is platform development. So you've seen us like launching some new platforms or new features. It's only because we have so much content at the back end, and we're just pulling that on a monthly or like on a quarterly basis to the right platforms.
Okay. Now you mentioned a radio show. You reminded me of something. I think a few years ago it used to be a radio person, right? I think 2002, 2003, before Miss Tanzania.
Yes.
Wait, before we go there, I'm taking you back through memory lane. Now this woman has been Miss Tanzania back in 2004. At the same time, you were a girl guide.
Yeah, that's way, way back.
Way, way back. And you were working with UNICEF at the same time when you were in secondary school.
Yeah.
You do a lot of things. I'm trying to imagine the transition from all of that. What is the learning experience out of that, and how do you take that to this?
I think the biggest learning experience would be, I don't know if it's teacher learning experience. I think I'm still coming to terms with that too. I get confused at times.
You do a lot.
No, I think I'm very diverse, which I think is really good. I think as a person, as a human being, we have so many, we have different strengths. Obviously, you cannot do everything that you think you can do or you want to do. But I really think being young, you have the chance and the allowance, because people forgive you more, to make mistakes, try things, and see really where your passion lies. So I really took advantage of being a young person, and I would just try things out. And in the process, I think it was, for me, it was a journey of finding myself, of finding what I really want to do, of finding where can I make an impact in my society, where can I really be productive, where am I really using my talents and my skills. And yeah, so I think over time, yes, I've tried. I've tried a number of things, but it was just a journey of me trying to find out who Faraja is, and I'm still on that journey actually.
Okay.
don't be surprised if you see me tomorrow starting like a civil engineering firm out of the blue.
You're a lawyer, right?
I am a lawyer.
So yes. I'm trying to imagine you saying a couple of things which I wasn't even understanding. Some of the things, API, whatever on the back end where people provide content. Some of the things are a bit technical. So I'm imagining you being a lawyer, kama mwanasheria, ambaye ina maanisha kusoma arts, si ndio?
Yes. Yeah.
Lakini kuna programming, kuna coding, kuna vitu vingine which I can't even describe. Ina maanisha unajifunza kwa vitu.
Yeah.
On the daily. And did you take a course au ni watu ambao unasumbua all the time? Oh, yeah, flani. Hebu help with this. How do you do it?
At first I had to it was almost a harassment. I had to harass a lot of people who are very good in the technical fields. I had to really get to work, collaborate, and really just ask for help from people who had gone before me in the technical space. I used to come here as well. I used to come here, I think it was before Bunit or something else. It was just a space, DTBI. And I would just hang around people from the technical and innovation spaces.
Yeah.
I would go to Kino Innovation Hub, and I really had to learn from experts in the field. I think that was the first thing that I had to do, just learn from people who are doing it every day.
Okay.
And to be able to know what exactly should be our direction, how should we structure our enterprise, but how should we structure our content and our platforms, what should we start with. And the other thing I had to learn by doing, I believe in doing something, like you just have to do it. One of the things that I believe in is like, to do is to become. So try to do it. It's really about just putting in the effort and trying something. And I had to learn a lot. So I would subscribe to like simple things like TechCrunch and just try to get the different ideas on how technology works, the trends, the global trends, regional trends. And yes, I had to also try programming. One of the people who used to teach me programming is actually somebody you had here, Caroline. From Apps and Girls.
Okay.
So my first programming, I don't know if it's a course or it's a crash course, was from Carol. She's trying to teach me very simple programming, but it was very difficult, like JavaScript and HTML. And I wasn't really looking into knowing how to code. I was looking into knowing how do they code. So that when I speak to our technical team now, I actually understand and they tell me, oh, this is what they're doing, there's this language you've been trying and it's not working out, perhaps you should do this language. I understand. So I wasn't learning programming to be able to become a programmer or to be able to become a coder. I still cannot code, but I understand the languages.
Okay.
Otherwise, it will be so difficult for me to communicate with them on a daily basis if I don't understand what they're doing. So I had to understand that. And again, it's a learning process at work. If you come to our office, we are all sitting in the same area. It's a proper like startup space. Lots of us, about 12 of us, but all sitting in the same space. And the idea is, so we have a teacher there. We have people from research. There's myself, there's finance, there's IT. We are all sitting in the same space. And the idea is there should be an easy flow of knowledge. So a person from finance might be saying something, perhaps maybe it's a QuickBooks failure and, oh, I don't know, like Sage or something. Probably the technical person is not really concerned with that, but they'll be hearing those things, and it becomes a very well-rounded situation in terms of how we work and develop our platforms.
Okay. I've listened to most of your interviews, and I usually hear you talking about family. You taking your kids kila siku asubuhi na mpeka mtoto wako au watoto wako wewe.
Well, when I'm there.
Shule. And you're always talking about the husband as well, mheshimiwa. And I think, how do you get the time to balance your life, which we're as a woman, lakini pia kazi, the many things that you're doing, make vingine sivitaja, and the family, being a socialite and everything else, how do you balance all of that?
No, you don't balance. I don't think there's a balance. I think what is important is just there has to be, I don't create like lines like this is work, this is family, or this is work, these are my friends. Like it's all, like I could be talking about work with my friends or with my husband, or my kids know what I'm doing. I could be responding to an email with guests, which is very offensive. But the point is, it has to be, I don't think it doesn't really work. I think you get very stressful if you don't enjoy your work, then you really create those lines. You really have to switch off at times, yes, but it's so important that everybody in your life are sort of synchronized in what you're doing and understanding, being part of the vision, I should say. And in that way, you don't have to struggle when you get home. Like, okay, I really have to do a Skype call now because perhaps it's morning hours in the US, but I can't because I'm home. And you can't even communicate that. So I think it's so important to actually just try to have, it's almost like a seamless kind of a life. Like, make sure everybody's involved in what you're doing. The balance, I don't know if there's a balance though. I think it's just life. You flow with what is there.
Hopefully, like, you spend most of the time with Sinafu.
No. No, when I switch off, when I switch off, I really do switch off. I can work from home too,
okay.
Which is, like, my kids go to sleep at 8, so I can usually work from 8 to, let's say, 11 or 12. I'm mostly a night person. So I'm not a morning person, so it really,
balances.
Maybe that's the balance now.
Okay, I think that's the balance. So I'm thinking now, you being a woman and a mother, or just being a person, or your gender, is it an advantage or disadvantage? How to ukitambulisha Faraja Kota Nyalandu, I am here. Is it an advantage to what you're doing? Or is it a disadvantage at times? Loans, grants, nakuja tu. Give that woman grants, don't you know her? Nikienda Seba, we don't know him, then put him aside.
Right.
Is it an advantage or a disadvantage?
It has never been, okay. Wow, okay. I think it's an advantage.
Tell us more.
Yes, okay. So when it comes to, it depends on the context. Mm-hmm. In some cases, it has been a serious disadvantage, being me.
Why?
I think being a woman, being young in our society, in some cases, it's not. And being ambitious, knowing what you want, and I think sometimes that comes as intimidating or as offensive to men. And it's also a matter of them not understanding, like, what are you talking about? How are you doing it? You probably don't know what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So it's a dismissal right from the outset. And what really happens is I have to prove myself twice as much, which I'm more than happy to do.
Because you're a lawyer.
Exactly. It's like, yeah, so that's the common thing. Like, you just have to prove yourself. And the most important thing, you just have to prove yourself over and over again. C- coming from the beauty queen industry, sort of the beauty pageant.
Beauty, yes. Yes. Beauty world.
Coming from that, it's also a disadvantage.
Mm.
And an advantage. The disadvantage is that there's so many prejudices that comes with that, and there's so many assumptions of who I am, what I'm capable of, what makes me, my values. I get judged from the outset, and my story is already told before I begin to tell my story. So I get almost defensive, but I have to start defending my story and expressing myself more. And it is an advantage that Miss Tanzania gave me a spotlight. It gave me fame, and from fame, whatever that I'm doing has greater visibility, unlike if I wasn't a Miss Tanzania. Okay. So I'm grateful for that, because probably it would take so much more effort to make Shule Direct be known, for instance, and if I was just a lawyer from somewhere starting a startup and doing what I'm doing. But there's a clear advantage in having the fame and be able to position it as something that I'm doing, because then it gets the spotlight that it deserves.
Mm-hmm. By any chance, sorry, I'm about to get a bit personal. By any chance, mheshimiwa hata kidogo naye anaweza kaigiza sauti yake sana. Sitaki mkongo angeke. Hebu mpeni tenda au nini. Or are you the kind of person, no. I can do this on my own, because we've heard your background. Tangu mwanzuru, umeanza mwenyewe, struggle. Is he by any chance right now, kitoa the moral support, lakini anasema bwana, we have to do this. Same when I'm tafutia mimi, kila kitu mtafutia mimi. How does it go?
The good thing is, all of the funding we have, for instance, all the financial support we've received is not from Tanzania.
Ah.
So, I don't know if it's a good thing, because there was no element of whoever supported us when we were applying for funding, they did not know who Faraja is. They did not know my history. They didn't know my husband. They didn't know. It was purely about the idea, purely about how we're going to implement the idea, and what impact are we seeking, and how we're going to achieve that impact, and how we're going to measure that impact.
I'm going to go to that in a few minutes, because you just gave me a point. But I'm thinking about Shule Direct, na watu kuweza kuaccess labda simu, na sio simu zote ambao labda vijijini wana simu, kuna wanafunzi wa sekondari kule wengi tu, na sio wote labda wana computers, na mpango pia mnao radio, TV, etc, etc. So how inakujaje, yani unafika hadi vijijini, you reach those kids, au what do you do?
We have users from countrywide, because again it's technology, so it could be a person who has traveled to, let's say, Kagera, and while there decided to subscribe or to access our website or to download our application. But we have plans of doing aggressive marketing, which is something which we've never done before. We've never done large-scale marketing in the past. We only tried to do it, I think, last year for the first time, like creating like a radio campaign.
Okay.
With Clouds After School Bash, through After School Bash with XXL.
Okay.
And we were going to do more of that. And I think we really felt that we were not ready. We were ready from the look of things, but I think it was just my own skepticism that we just have to be able to ensure that we have stable systems, we have reliable platforms, and we have alternatives that if a person doesn't have, for instance, an application, a smartphone to download the Android application, we should give them an alternative of getting it over an SMS. A person should be able to access our website. If they don't, they should be able to, if they don't have, let's say, data, they should be able to access it over Facebook's internet.org for free. And so it was a matter of providing alternatives as well, and looking at a place where we are stable and we can now engage more users in the market. And growth is good, but growth has to be systematic too. Like, we have to be at a place where we can afford to have more users, we can engage more users, and we can keep them all happy. So I think we just had to take it slowly.
Talking to you right now, you're making me think about success and failure. So I'm thinking, with the course that you've gone through, or the situation that you've been, mambo yote ambayo unapitia sasa hivi, mtu mwingine anaweza kusema labda yapitie pitia changamoto, kuna matatizo au nini, which brings me back to the question ambayo uko nasema most of the grants ambazo unapata misaada whatever ni kutoka nje. And I'm imagining kuna vijana wengi hapa au other startups au young entrepreneurs ambao wanajaribisha, a lot of people tunaandika email sana hapa that tunaomba, we get rejected so many times. Na kuna wengine ambao tumepata bahati, once in a while we get a reply, unapata grant, unajaribisha tena unakosa. How many times do you do it? Do you try? Do you fail? Do you move on? Do you stop? Unaenda serikalini, what do you do? Do you cry? Do you write more emails?
Yeah, crying is part of it. Yeah, I cry a lot. Okay, actually, so in the audience, this is our general manager, Iku. Iku, hi. How many times do you write proposals?
Iku, you can wave.
Hi.
Hi, Iku. Okay. Every day.
Every other day.
Wow.
Yeah.
Recently, I think I gave her a break. It was the one that you.
Yeah.
I got a break because I
can't. A proposal for a grant or a loan?
Grant.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
Yeah, I actually got a brain freeze. I think they overworked me. It's true. You just have to do it so often.
You get so many
rejects as well.
Yeah.
And mind you, all of our products are able to generate revenues on their own. Each of our individual products can generate revenues, but you still have to get all these grants, get support, and you just have to keep on doing it. There has to be somebody who's doing it.
Okay.
In your office or in your startup, if it's you, somebody has to do it.
Think about this, but no, but then you mniambia, naandikaga kila siku hizi proposal kama
sio kila siku, lakini okay, so it takes time. So for instance, if you're doing one, it might take maybe 3 days to complete, or 4 days. And so you start one, there's a deadline, you submit, you go for another one. You do get some, you get rejected, and yeah.
Okay. So any plans that umesema mlijaribu kidogo mass marketing last year? This year kidogo mnapanga kuendeleza kidogo?
Yes.
So far, I know Shule Direct kwa Tanzania.
Yes.
Any plans about kupeleka outside?
Yes, we do have plans. We already have secured partnerships.
Okay.
So we're going to launch in Rwanda and in Kenya, and hopefully the rest of the East African countries next year. It's only those two countries for this year.
But most of the grants in the smaller country, is the government playing any part to Labak's idea? In any way?
Clearly, yes. We work with the Ministry of Education through Tanzania Institute of Education, but they only, actually, it's a partnership that they had to create a committee to review our content, but we had to kind of consult the committee, so we pay them as consultants.
Okay.
And the committee reviews all of our content to ensure that it's the subject matter is according to the national curriculum, and we also had to engage language experts to ensure that the language and grammar is according to, it's grammatically correct.
Okay.
And so we do work with them in that form of partnership to ensure that all of our content has gone through that quality assurance process. We financially, I would say no, and we have never gone for government support. I think they have such a workload as it is, we all know, and there's so many priorities as a country, as a government, which needs the government's support. And we're more than happy to find alternatives to ensure that we can do what we're doing. Yeah.
Now, so before Shule Direct, was the government doing a similar thing, like Labda Kidogo? Or
anybody else?
Nothing at all?
Nothing. Not in the government, not in the private sector. Yes. So there wasn't anything like it before. There was things like it. But it wasn't how we've made it. So the way we've structured it, everything is local, as I said before, it's based on the national curriculum. We had to digitize the entire syllabus for the 11 subjects, and we had to ensure that every single concept in the syllabus has content.
Okay.
And yes, it takes time, but we are glad that we've done it.
Umesema, Shule Direct is a social enterprise, it's not even. Now imagine kuna evaluation au kuna check and balance zote. Kama for example, kama ni profit organization, kwa wanaangalia, okay, tumepata milioni moja mwezi huu, mwezi ujao tumepata milioni tano, that's how wanajievaluate, tunazidi kuongezeka. Lakini kama social enterprise, labda naangalia pia, the need that you're putting there, is it felt? vitu kama hivyo. How do you evaluate yourself kusema kwamba sasa tumwafikia wanafunzi kiasi fulani hivi na hivi, wameelewa, wame download hizi quiz, wamepata mark, yani how is the check and balance, how is the evaluation?
Yeah, it's so important. So we do have a monitoring and evaluation department who do exactly that. They do it on a weekly basis. They evaluate all our digital analytics from our digital platforms. But we also engage in qualitative studies to ensure that we get feedback from our users in the community qualitatively. So we do focus group discussions, we do questionnaires to just kind of understand what we're providing. Is it really useful? What can be done better? Is it improving their test scores, for instance? Is it improving the... So there's also an aspect of new learning behavior, something which we are also tracking. And it's not a common dimension. I think the challenge with our field, because it's educational technology, it's really difficult to measure impact in a way that is clean. Most impact studies dictate that it has to be a very... You really have to do... Like clean studies, ensuring that there's no, if you're doing, let's say, understanding, for instance, if Shule Direct had an impact in a student's life or in a student's performance, to ensure that it's clean, you need to remove all the other factors. There shouldn't be a teacher, there shouldn't be a textbook, there should be no school, but then you can't really do that. These are students. And so you can't really have very clean findings in terms of, we can't really say, I don't know, like Seba got a division one and it's because of Shule Direct. We can't say that statement. We wish we can. We've had some good feedback from students who said, I did so well because I was studying on Shule Direct, but we can't credit it to ourselves. Some people would, but we just couldn't. We don't think it's ethical. And we do engage teachers and students both, because it's so important for us to also work with teachers, not just in creating content, but as one of our users, because we have about 5,000 teachers now.
That are providing content?
That are subscribing to our
content. 5,000
teachers. So they use it for teaching in schools.
Now on a phone, how many students?
We have about 400,000.
400,000 students. I wish I knew the statistics ya wanafunzi hapa kwa wangapi Tanzania. Hapa wangapi hapa wanajua? I don't know. How many? Wako wanafunzi wangapi? Secondary school students. Maka may reach 400,000. That's a lot. That's a lot.
So what, 1.8?
Wow. Okay. Now, I'm thinking the biggest challenge I'm about to face right now.
I think the biggest challenge will be the growth of technology. We really hope that when you see rising cost of data, for instance, that's a disadvantage for us. We are on, again, as I said before, free basics by internet.org. So if you have free basics, you can access the web platform at least for free. But I think the other thing, one of our products is a learning management system that we sell as a license to schools. It's not, so it's a school edition and you also have a home edition. I think the biggest challenge with that is there's a low level of technology, should I call it understanding or appreciation? I think appreciation.
I think both, appreciation
and understanding. And the potential of technology and how it can improve that school's academic performance.
True.
Or just learning outcomes in general. And it takes a lot to convince a school to subscribe or to license our learning management system. I think the effort is so much, I feel like we should be charging more.
Okay.
Because then eventually they will take it, but then you've done quite a lot of convincing to actually get them to license it. Mm. But they will leave it. So I think it's just, again, I think it's a social issue and I hope over time it's going to change.
Recently, nimechaguliwa kuwa, sorry, ni kuna World Economic Forum, wako kuna education department, right?
Yes.
And I'm trying to connect here na Shule Direct, this that was a balance and everything else you're doing right now.
Mm. Mm. So that is more of it's a consultative role. It's more like a board member, so it doesn't engage me full time.
Okay.
I do get to review a lot of documents and write in a lot of comments and inputs for the education strategies or education dynamics globally. But I was quite honored and humbled.
We apply. Maki najua na apply to figure that out.
I did not.
Alichagua.
I did not.
Efforts are done online.
Yes, clearly it was because of Shule Direct,
okay.
And I just got an email appointment emails. Yeah. Actually, I almost ignored the email. And then I was like, okay, this is actually real. And yeah, a complete appointment. I did not solicit. You get invited to join. You can't solicit. You can't apply. You just get invited to join.
Now, I'm imagining to say kuna crowd yetu hapa, a lot of people wamekaa wakisikiliza. And I think a lot want to follow that lane now that, oh, take a different route, like any get to where you are. Probably talk to the same people I'm going to provide grants, follow the right channels, or people I'm going to put on YouTube maybe. Is there more market? Is there more space? Is there more room to grow? Is there more room to do the same business or social enterprise? What is the repercussion of all of this?
There's such a great room. So what I usually tell myself and what I usually say is that whenever you see a challenge, whenever you see whether it's an economic challenge, a social challenge, any challenge, there is a solution for that challenge. And anything that you're trying to do, make sure that you are addressing that challenge. You're creating a solution for a problem. And we all know there are so many problems in our community, ranging from education, health, agriculture, environment, you name it. I mean, it's just, we're surrounded by problems, unfortunately. And all of those problems call for us to create solutions for them. And I really think it's entirely up to us to be able to, the saying goes, you should think out of the box, but then there's just no box, just think. Just think, look at the problem, look at the challenge, and think what can work for that. And the answer is always in the challenge itself. The solution lies around there. Look at the behaviors of people in that situation. Look at what are they already using? What are they likely to use in 6 months' time? What are they likely to be their lifestyle, for instance, in a year's time? It's always around the same issue that you're able to develop a solution or a company or a social enterprise. I love the idea of a social enterprise because it allows a person or a group of people, a team, to be able to create solutions that are aiming for impact, but at the same time they're able to generate profits.
Okay.
And that shouldn't be a route for everyone. Another person might aim purely to just make money. So you sell airtime, for instance. Okay. Eventually, yes, somewhere down the line there'll be an impact, there'll be a social impact. But just find yourself, know what you want. And I think it's that purpose that will really keep you going when it gets difficult. And again, the first few years or the first few months will be very difficult.
Last question before I leave the floor to you guys. Swala la mwisho kabisa, la kizushi, by the way.
Okay.
How many jobs do you have?
Una kazi ngapi? Jobs? Now one.
Are you sure? How many jobs?
Wow, okay. I did a lot of things. About four.
The last speaker that we interviewed, Imelda Nomanga, I think you know her,
yes,
from back.
I don't know her.
She's doing a lot of things right now, Pia. Alikuame, I remember she talked about challenges as a face, Pia, as a publishing person. Alijaribu kuchanganya vitu vingi sana. Vikaja, vingine vikaharibika. And she akasema, let me try to focus on one baby that I have. Maybe nikija ku revamp, it'll be better. So I'm trying to, now you're giving me the opposite.
I know.
Because you're giving me everything. You're doing hiki, hiki, hiki. And I see things that you do online. Nasema, oh, dada. How do you do it? So, in a idea to do so many things at once, or should I take it, or there's no formula?
Okay, there's no formula. I think, again, it's very individual based. As I said earlier, I'm still trying to find myself. I'm on a journey. And I think sometimes I'm driven by the idea to create. I love the opportunity to create, I love the opportunity to innovate, to think how things can be done differently. And so I tend to grab such opportunities very fast. Like if I see it as an opportunity, I'll grab it. And some of them are very short-lived. Like I might do something for like a year and it's completed, I'll just move on to something else. And then the other thing is, part of finding yourself is knowing, because I think you might do one thing which kind of drives your passion more. Like your heart or your soul, like it's something that you really, really like to do. Probably doesn't pay you much, but you really, really like to do it. And then there might be something else that drives your figures in the bank accounts. That's like, that sorts out your bottom lines. Okay. And that, you also have to channel yourself in that way.
Okay.
But then you're not doing it for your heart or for your soul. It does nothing for your soul. You're just purely doing it for money.
Yeah.
I do that too. And there's probably something else that you're doing it because you feel like it's a very good idea, it has the potential to grow, it's not yet there, but you're willing to put in your effort to help it. Or, so I think it's just knowing when you're doing something. Part of finding yourself.
Part of finding yourself means go but do something for your heart and for your tummy, yeah? Mesia, do something for your heart and your tummy.
And for your mind too.
And for your mind.
You need to stimulate your mind.
Yes.
So you do things that just stimulate your mind.
Okay. Now, Faraja, nashukuru sana, Faraja kota Nyalandu. We had her as our first guest, 2017, Startup Grind. And this is how the grind is. She's doing a lot, and a lot is working and paying. Now, ametuambia kabisa kwamba, it didn't happen only in a minute or a second. It took her some years. So I think everybody is going through a process, all of us. I'm about to find different startups. Nashukuru sana, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Seba, thank you.
Now, it's time for you guys. Maka, I think I've asked a lot. Nimeongea sana. And she's also answered a lot. So, any question, any advice, please, number to continue kuuliza. Let's be very precise. Let's go straight to the point. Let's not beat around the bush sana. Ili tuweze kumaliza mapema. Imelda, jitambulishe nani, what do you do? And yes, if you have a whatever organization, tuambie alafu. Please, number smile me.
Yes.
Answer Mwanzo. Sorry.
Okay. My name is Ilda. I work for IBM as a software specialist.
Okay.
So I have two questions for you to add to that. First of all, you know, great job, guys. I think it's a much needed platform, obviously, for our students here. So I wanted to know what type of content do you have? Do you have any dynamic content like video, images, and audio, or is it mainly using text? And then second question is about sustainability, because whenever I think of social enterprise, I think that's one thing that's definitely, you know, you must have in mind. In how many years do you see Shule becoming so sustainable? Because obviously now you're depending on grants, you're having to write proposals every week, but do you see yourself moving to like a full self-sustaining model?
Thank you, Mel.
Great. So to answer the first question, all of our content now is HTML text-based format. And the reason why we really focus on having HTML is because most people, when you think of yourself when you want to get on YouTube, the way you think of data and how much it's going to be consumed. So think of a person who wants to learn. So perhaps you want to maybe download a music video and you think of data. So think of education. Will you be able to download, let's say, an entire course notes for, let's say, history from two without thinking of data? And so eventually we decided that we really have to focus on text-based notes only because our users can't afford to have multimedia content. But we do have multimedia content in our pipeline. But it's just a matter of how our users can engage with content. So if you look at our growth as well, we've really focused on how users can come in. We started with a website, then we got on the learning management system, only because schools were coming to us asking for our content. So we had to give them in a system. Then we went to SMS, because users, we figured that if users can now, they started knowing about Shule Direct, then we have to think of how can they access the same content over a feature phone and not over a smartphone. Because also, most of our users, we are accessing the website over feature phones and not smartphones. So you can imagine if you're watching a video and you have a Kitochi, it's almost, you can't do it. So we are very user-centered and very user-focused. We pride ourselves in having what they call human-centered designs. So everything that we're doing starts from the user's perspective to like to the rest of the world. Yeah, and
sustainability.
Yes, we do hope it will be sustainable. It's just that it will take time. It will take time because the type of consumers and the type of content we have. If we were doing, like music videos, for instance, or if you're doing entertainment, it pays a lot more. Or e-commerce. So let's say if you had an e-commerce platform, it pays a lot more because it's something that's merchandise based. It's very fast paced as well. But anything that is social, look at education, look at health, they're very hard to finance. A person to be able to buy something that's in health or in education is actually very, it takes a lot. Because you have so many competing, again, priorities. Maybe they want to have food on the table, they want to have clothes on their back, and then you're coming here with biology, let's say, quizzes. So it's also a consumer issue in how they prioritize education and many social development factors. So you hope that over time that mindset is going to change and they'll be able to subscribe and get our platforms. Our highest paying product actually is the learning management system that we sell to schools. The most common one is the website, but the highest paying is the learning. So it's a matter of balancing as well. And as I said earlier, we really focus on developing our repository, the content repository, because then from that repository, we can connect to any platform and ensure that we have so many platforms, and it's just a balance of which platforms is the highest paying and which one is not. So over time, I think we'll just be able to create like a stable line of all platforms to be able to self-sustain and not depend on another platform to sustain itself.
Are we good, Imelda?
Yeah.
Tuko sawa. Gentlemen, I love about tiki na ba.
Nitakujua upande wa Shule Direct. Ye, Shule Direct, nivokola kusikiliza kwamba na mpango kuwa na hiyo kinoza kama daya mpango mpia, nitaka kutoka kwa daya ya sola mpanda. Kwa nataka kuwa na kutengeneza sustainability, kwamba biashara sustainable. Asa hile kutengeneza sustainability, mwana fikiria, pia mna mpango kufungua ba chuo, haba kozi mbalimbali ambazo watu wanaweza kuingia online wanasoma, and then tunakuwa na teacher, and then inakuwa na zile online class ambapo tofauti na sasa hivi nilivyoiona Shule Direct. Je, pia watu ambao mnakutana Shule Direct, je, ni pekee yao kindergarten, secondary, hadi chuo au wale watu ambao wa ofisi, je, mnatarget watu wa gani? Na je, mna future gani kwamba ya kutarget ile group kama mna target secondary, je, mna future ya kwanza kufikiria kutarget watu ambao wa ofisini hata kuongeza shule? Na nadhani hiyo ndio content ambayo inalipa zaidi kwa sababu wanashikilia nini, wanakuwa na financial muscle kubwa kuliko wale wanafunzi wa primary na wanafunzi wa secondary. Je, mna mpango gani wa expansion kwa ya namna hiyo? Na lingine la mwisho, nimekuwa nasikia tu kwamba mnatafuta grants. Sijasikia kwamba mtafuta mfano kwamba katika ISP au kuna vitu kama Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange, vitu kama Nairobi Stock Exchange. Nikaenda kwenye list hii, biashara zilikuwa sasa na watu kala vizuri, na wajua kuweka biashara Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange ndio njia rahisi ya kupata capital, na njia rahisi ya kupata pia capital unaweza kuenda na equity firm zipo nyingi hapa, nadhani zipo mbili au tatu kama hapa Tanzania. Ukienda Nairobi zimejaa, ukienda South Africa nyingi kutosha, na wakakuta zile kila mwaka equity firm hizi private equity firm nyingi zimebezi Nigeria, zimebezi Kenya na pia na South Africa nyingi na upande wa North Africa. So je, una mpango gani kwamba wakuweza kutafuta hawa watu ambao kuweza aidha iwe ni public, ukaenda kuisubscribe kwenye Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange, ambapo watu watasubscribe. Najua kuna biashara kama mbili ambazo zilizofahamu waliteka Dar es Salaam Stock Exchange, and then walipata think 8 billion kwa raise ile. Kwa hiyo yeye nyinyi kama na uhitaji wa na wanaga commission yote, mnaifu kwamba ufuate zile ufuate zile masharti ambayo kwa listed, kwa sababu kuna process fine ambayo ni fupi tu. So ndio. So, what is the view of that?
Santi, Mr. Nani?
Kilani.
Yes. Santi, Santi.
Okay, I'll start with the last question.
Okay, expansion.
No, it was, yeah. Type of company, yes. I think.
Type of company.
Yes, yeah. So, we are registered as a company limited by guarantee. And for that reason, we do not have share capital to provide to a venture capitalist or an investment firm. When we started, we thought of going for those kind of capital, so we did a lot of that, and it was just one rejection letter after another, and realized at some point that we're actually doing it the wrong way. So there's no way we can get venture capital or investment capital, because we have no equity to provide to them. We have guarantors and not directors in the company.
Okay.
So it's the way our registration is done, and it's done that way because of our mission to be able to focus more on impact and balance it off with our business and financial models. And I think the other question was the type of content. Yes. So something which I did not plan on talking about here, because I thought this is more for Shule Direct, but we do have Shule Plus, and Shule Plus is for profit, and it's exactly what you were saying. It's a company limited by share capital, and yes, right now we are fundraising, we're going for venture capital, and we're providing equity to investors. And Shule Plus is focusing on what we call learning beyond school. So it's the knowledge and skills that you need as a young person after school, or you could be in school, but perhaps the education provided isn't really sufficient to your demands or your employability demands or your entrepreneurship demands. So Shule Plus is more of a continuation. It's an offspring, it's a baby of Shule Direct, but it's more of a continuation of education beyond secondary school. So we look at the skills and knowledge that aren't really provided by our education curriculums or systems, and what can work in the 21st century in this market for both employability or employment and entrepreneurship. There's another question.
Okay, ili kuongezea, maana kuna ongelea pia wafanyakazi or people that are working. For example, kama nataka kujiendeleza kielimu. If I go to Shule Plus, it
is. Yes, so if you go to Shule Plus, then you'll be able to get that content.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, kuna kozi mbalimbali.
Okay. Are you satisfied? Mwingine tena?
And thank you for that vote of confidence. You thought of there is some stock exchange for us. Oh my God. Thanks.
Yeah. Mr. Where are you? Yeah. Mwitambulishe nani? Short and clear, precise?
Yeah.
Okay.
I work with CIB, but founder of Zimba. I just want to ask like two questions. One, you said there is a room for your husband, I mean like the hubby, the name that you're using, second name, to take you from zero to somewhere. Have you decided to try to figure out a way out to support other youngsters who are coming, who doesn't have any support? How many, or have you, do you have any idea or thought of trying to groom some of them? That's our first question. The second one is, does the political atmosphere or political position of your husband sometimes affect your business, affect whatever you're doing? When things goes ups and down, does it affect your business or your room, your position, your business is still the same? Thank you.
Okay, let me just so kama namsaidia kujibu, lakini one of the things I remember her saying ni kwamba akuongelea Mr. kwamba yeye ana mchango sana, even though ukuza na mchango, but aliongelea agenda zake tangu mwanzo she has been doing even without him being in the picture. But I think maybe the main question from that ni kwamba are you helping somebody else, are you grooming people to be more like Faraja or nini, watu ambao hawana platform, hawana majina. Yeah.
So I think maybe to answer the first question, we are all made by people around us. So yes, I have to give credit to everyone who is around me, and my husband, of course. And there's a significant amount of support that comes from that. It's to me as a person and not to the business. And it's so important to actually be able to kind of create a line between your business and your personal life, because that goes now into a second question. If you don't create that line, and not necessarily in terms of what I was saying here, the work-life balance, but in terms of their inputs, or I don't know which kind of support you mean, but ultimately it's so important to ensure that your business has proper systems that can enable it to stand on their own. not with or without the support of somebody else, but including yourself. So imagine if you have, God forbid, cerebral cancer, malaria. Yes, yeah, the one that can go crazy, and you lose your entire memory for like 5 days. So what happens to your company? And I think that's a challenge for most people here in Tanzania, maybe the rest of Africa, is that we have so many, like we create companies or businesses around ourselves and not around systems. If you do not have systems, your business will end up depending on people and not on the systems you've created. And what happens if those people go, including yourself? Your business will fail. And that is why you find that you have a business, the CEO dies, the business after 5 years, 3 years just collapses. It's only because there is no strong foundation of systems that is holding that business to ensure that it outlives the founder. What I hope is that if I leave Shure Direct today, it should be able to go on. That's how I created it. It should be able to sustain itself. So it doesn't matter if Faraja is here or if Faraja's husband is here. Oh, if Seba is, I know Seba, if Seba is here or is not here, it has to sustain itself with the right systems.
Okay.
Yeah. And yes, supporting other young people, I try a lot. But it's very hectic. This is my idea of support. I hope that with what we're doing with Shure Direct and Shure Plus, it's a way of supporting them too. We are helping them to fulfill their potential, to reach what they want to achieve in life. It's not directly to me. I do try, but yeah, it's a time issue. Yes, and then the political atmosphere. Again, I think that goes to the systems.
Yeah.
It's creating credible systems and ensuring that they're not personal people based, they're system based.
I think she answered your question. Could you? Sorry. Diana. Yes. Lady Diana. You've been pointing out from the briefs and I saw your hand.
Millennium Engineering. So I had one, it's a question, but at the same time it's a recommendation. From what I understood, it's the program you have is more web-like, it's a network, like web-based. It's not yet undigitalized, meaning it's not on paper, like I can access Shule direct from a stationery. That is what I'm trying to tell you. I look at your business in my perspective. It is a really good, the first initiative is really great, but for Tanzania specifically, you need to think about it in an undigitalized manner in order to penetrate smoothly and faster, not just smoothly, but in a really impactful way. You have 400,000 students at the moment, but I would like to hear 1.5 million students. And how do you get that? You move from being digitalized to undigitalized from the time being until you have all, let's say, a majority of number of students having access to your platform. Now, how do you do that? Like you mentioned a part that you do lots of research, and I believe that, and you know exactly what the government is directing in terms of budget, in terms of education. So you can go to with a proposal, not to ask for funding, but to ask for a certain percent in that budget to elevate your platform into the undigitalized place. We have lots of schools at Kata, which are secondary schools, and they don't have this access, I believe so. But how do you reach them? Now you sit down with the ministry and tell them, I think this is a platform. It has worked for 400,000 students. I believe it will work for 1.5 million students. And how do I do that? We will do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that's where you will move at the speed of light. And not just for Tanzania, and I hope you cut across Africa sometime. And I wish you all the best for the great job. Thank you.
That was a suggestion, recommendation. It wasn't a question, eh? Thank you. Okay. Ben.
Ben, I have a startup and I work at people are education, it's not the kids to score division 1 or division 2. That's not the main problem. The main problem is how do you have the kids who are competent enough, let's say you know, you're 4, is he competent enough compared to the year that I'm going to spend 4 years or 5 years at Shule? Like, you already, let's say, for the black people, do something to be education or whatever. So, in your Shule Direct, what are you doing when you get ways or things instead of what's the idea to put a division 1 or division 2? That's the question.
Nisema mwanzoni, nia yetu sio kumsaidia mwanafunzi kupata division 1 au division 2 peke yake. Kwa bahati mbaya hiyo ndio indicator kwamba amefaulu au ameelewa darasani au alikuwa anasoma. Kwa jamii ilivyo na system za elimu duniani zilivyo, lazima ufaulu somo lako ili kujua kwamba uko kule unasoma. Lakini tunaangalia sana uwezo wa mtu amejengwa na elimu kiasi gani, ameelimika, na kujua kama ameelimika tunaanza kuangalia vitu vingine. Nilisema kidogo kuhusu kuangalia tabia za kujifunza. Mtu anakaa na content au anakaa na somo kwa muda gani kwa mfano. Na ukiangalia muda ambao mtu ana engage na elimu au ana engage na kusoma, ina impact moja kwa moja kwenye kitu ambacho anakisoma. Kama hakremation, okay? Ingine anza kama makeup. Amekaa kwa naimba. Lakini kwenye Shule Direct kama ilivyo, sisi nia yetu ni kuchukua elimu ambayo ni mtaala wa taifa na kufanya ukawa unapatikana kwa kila mwanafunzi. Kwa bahati mbaya nzuri, nisema mwanzoni kwamba 89% ya shule za sekondari Tanzania ni shule za serikali, kwa maana kwamba wanatumia mtaala wa taifa na sio IB au IGCSE. Kwa hiyo hao 89% tunataka wasome, waelewe na waelimike baada ya form 4. Kigezo moja hapo ni kufaulu mtena form 4. Lakini tunaamini kwamba kama akielimika, ukijifunza kwa mfano mchukua kitu gani, chukua let's say civics, ni elimu ya uraia, lakini inakusaidia zaidi ya faulu kupata A kwenye civics pale form 4. Kwa hiyo hatutumii mtaala tofauti kwa mtaala ule wa taifa, lakini the way tumetengeneza masomo yetu sasa, kama ukiangalia, ukiingia online tunakwambia ukichukua kitabu cha civics kwenye bookshop na ukiangalia civics sisi tulivyoweka kwenye mtandao wetu ni tofauti, sababu sisi tumefocus kwenye lengo la kujifunza hiyo topic ni lengo gani. Tukia kwenye hilo lengo, so it's based on concepts and we have the entire content structured around concepts. Kwa hiyo namsaidia mwanafunzi pia kujua dhumuni la kujifunza kile kitu akiwa anasoma. But now on the other hand, Shule Plus doesn't really focus on any curriculum. It's universal. It's even the way we create our content, it's based on market research. We ask people, what do you want to learn? And they suggest to us, I want to learn how to create a company. I want to learn how to maybe use social media for my business. I want to learn how to turn my idea into a business. So it doesn't follow any curriculum. It follows people's recommendations. It's very context driven. It's very contextual, very demand driven.
Unfortunately, we live in a situation ambayo you're judged by the last paper. Ukifaulu mtihani wako wa mwisho, unaonekana you're better. Ukifeli, unaonekana you're not. Unfortunately, that's the curriculum.
It is unfortunate, it's true. It's kind of that saying, but you cannot judge, is it a snake by its ability to climb a tree or something like this?
Yes.
Yeah, or something, or a lion, spumbuki. But yes, it's a very standardized format, which perhaps doesn't make sense in the current world, but that's, unfortunately, that's how it
yes,
still
is.
It's probably going to change something.
Hopefully, it's here. Okay. Yeah, but don't worry, I'll put your point. Let's make it very brief, so we can get to Maliza.
My name is Mimi, and I work with Shule Plus. It's a media platform, but again, I'm a social worker. I'm trying to come up with a solution that provides my education. So I have three things. I have a request, I have a recommendation, and I have a question. So I will start with the question. On the learning management platform information, do you have government schools, like the public schools also as your clients? And who exactly buys in? Is it an individual school or is it like the ministry that buys in for a number of schools? That was the question. And my recommendation or suggestion is when you say you cannot take the credit for like the impact you give to the students, although they can say themselves that they are getting something from it. Have you ever tried like something like an experimental research design?
where you conduct random, it's called a random control trial, where you can test, like you can expose some students to the Shule director and another group that is not exposed, and try to measure and see whether there is something new in this group compared to this, then you can still take credit. And my request is, can you be my mentor?
Oh, that was fast.
That was fast. That was nice.
Nice. Thank you. Yes, I will take. Oh, okay, I will take the first question. What it was about?
I think it was a recommendation. The first one was a recommendation.
Yeah.
Was it a question?
Yes, we do. We do have public schools, and so for public schools, it's easy for a school to get. For public schools, it's easy for them to get a sponsorship. So for instance, we'll be working with Tigo. I don't know if you've heard of Tigo eSchools. They've done about 60 schools. They're doing, I think, 150. So we'll be installing the learning management system in the schools that are supported by Tigo. So it's Tigo who are paying for the system to have the platform in the schools. It's actually a government initiative, but then the government did not have the funding, so Tigo supported the government. And in turn, they're also getting content from us. The other thing, which is, yeah, and for private schools, it's a private school licensing. So you can imagine pitching to the academic master and the headmaster for a single license, because we license it per school. And yeah, that's what I was trying to say earlier. Like, I feel like there has to be so much more. Perhaps you can even charge for all the pitches that we keep on doing to the private schools, because then it's individual sales. Yeah.
Okay.
And then the other question.
The
randomized control trial. Yes, so even with the randomized, it's something that I was trying to avoid going to, like in depth, but even with that, so you think of the control group and the test group, even at that level, can you imagine, so let's say you have one group that's a control group and the other one is a test group, and they both go to school, they both get educated with their teachers or their textbooks, and then you expose one group to Shule Direct. Even at that point, you can't really say that you can't really say they passed their Form 4 exams, for example, based on using Shule Direct. We can only say the group that was exposed to Shule Direct improved. You know, it becomes a very long sentence. So we just pride ourselves that we create access to 400,000 students, the numbers that we can actually prove, and we can back them up. I'm really keen on finding like the proper research methodology that we can use to have very clean results. And yes, if you have any suggestion that can really make sure that we have very clean findings that are not contaminated by other factors, we'll be more than grateful.
I think she already made the point. She wants you to be her mentor, Koyo. I think she'll look for you after this. Now guys, we have only a few minutes. We only have like 10 minutes. I like everybody askike vizuri. So ningependa nichukue haraka haraka nne ya mwisho. Mongeza, let's make it very quick and precise. Dada. What's your goal?
20s kind of people think like the 20s are more like of a liberating age, like you can do so much, like you actually feel very inhibited. it's a time ambao pia can actually be very sort of free and take so many risks, but then for some reason you just don't. And now I can take more risks, I can try so many things, but the problem is there's so much more to risk now than in my 20s. Like, you think of so much more, you think of time, you think of so many factors. So I wish I did, you feel like I did so much, but I feel like I could have done
more.
I could have done so much more. And I think in your 20s you get so sensitive with people's judgments. You're always like, what are they going to say? What are they going to think about me? How are they going to take this? Are they going to like me even after all of this? And you think of other people more, and it's like they'll still say something, they'll still judge you, they'll still be skeptical of whatever you want to do. So I think the best thing about your 20s is just follow your passion. If you want to do a gazillion things, just go ahead and do them. If a gazillion things fail, so be it. You will probably have learned something out of the failures, and you move on and try something else until you find your passion and what you can really do. So I think it's just take the plunge.
You know, there's somebody that wants to kill me right now. There are two people that want to kill me. So let's make it quick. Now I'm doing this because I love you guys. My brother over there, you've been pointing your hands for a while. Okay.
First of all, I would like to say, you know, I don't know about the rest, but I think we share the same thing, and that is the curiosity to do things and the curiosity to see our dreams come true. And the last one, the curiosity to learn from others who have made, like a sister or whatever. Now, when it comes to startup, like I'm trying to think, the time before Shule was live, I mean, we have a lot of ideas in our head. I think most of us, we are planning to do things, to start business, but coming to reality, just a human person living in an area like Nandese, and he or she wanna start a startup. There are so many things we have to do there to set up a business, including the rent and other things. And if it's a tech startup, we have to pay for the servers to host your website, and I mean, you have to encounter a lot of things. So at the end of the day, it's very, very difficult, and that's why we're here and just trying to see if we can also do our business and do some things so that we can come out as a big business. And now when we come here, you know, people can have different imagination. Same around over there, people have suggestions like, oh, because maybe he went for the Reach for Change competition and he was given a prize of which boosted a business. And also others who think like her husband is somebody else, of which maybe me, I'm just a young person, my parents are just normal as I am, and we are suffering from this something called the poverty. So I want you to advise or tell us, what can we do just on the early stages of the startup? Like after I have my idea and I want it to start, there are lots of things I have to do, and nobody will not trust you. You are having to tell yourself, and my brother was here, he said he's an investor, but if you come and say, I'm my business, I want you to invest in it. It's very, very difficult. It's very, very difficult. That's one. And the second one, could you please tell us, could you please tell us, what do you think if there was no support for it for change for your business? How would it be like for this time? Thank you.
Very good question. Yeah. So, sure, direct kati naanza. Hewe ni...
Yeah.
Mwakati naanza. Tulianza. Chakwanza mbacho nadhani ni muhimu sana. Ni collaboration. Hautokuwa unajua kila kitu. Kwa lazima upate watu ambao watakuwa unajua baadhi ya vitu ambavyo wewe hujui. So you really have to get the right team. Now, you mentioned something which is very interesting. One of the things that you thought you needed manzoni was rent. And actually you don't need rent. And that's the problem. You actually just need to have a good idea to start with. Good idea, and then know, how do I make this idea work? You really have to research your idea and your industry. If you want to do something in retail, let's say a retail shop, you just have to know your market, you have to know your customers, you have to know what you're going to be selling in that shop. It's the same thing with any startup. You really have to have an idea, research your idea, know your industry, and get the right people on the team. So it's so easy for someone to come back, like when we started, nipata support kubwa. No, I had money. I could easily get an office anywhere ambako ningetaka. I did not get an office anywhere. I used to go to Kinu. Kinu, kama nakumbuka Kinu, yuko kuna zimeza. Yes. I used to go to Kinu, nikuwa silipi, sababu wakati bado kwa jika structure ya kulipia. So they had highest tools. Anybody who used to go to Kinu in 2013 probably like knows me. I used to go there, nakuwa kwenye ile stool. That's where I met our first, one of the co-founders of Enterfires. He's a technical engineer. I met him there, and it's only because we were conversing on education and he had the technical skills, and he agreed to come on board and build our first platform. And Iku at the back, she's the general manager. Iku had just returned from Rwanda, where she's working as a project manager, and she's a project management specialist, and I had to convince her as well to join in and support the vision. With no pay. So Fayaz and Iku, I had the money, or maybe if you want to put it in another way, my family had the money, but it had to be in a very its own compartment. It had to grow at its own pace. It had to grow at its own, I think its own, it had to set up its own foundation. And it's so easy, and whenever you get, you know, whenever you get freebies or you get bailouts or somebody comes and tells you, oh, I'll give you an office, it makes you lazy. That's the problem. And that's what we really don't get to understand. If somebody gives you money to start your startup, at a point where you don't even know what you want to do, you just become flat out lazy. You really have to be able to build your startup on your own terms, in its own space, ground up. And that's how you make it. And again, you're establishing these systems over time, so you really need to be able to, the struggle is actually good. It makes you think hard. It makes you really think of things like value for money, which otherwise you wouldn't be think of because you have all the money. So yes, we worked at Kinu, and then we moved to Mara Foundation. So Mara Foundation used to be at Mayfair Plaza. And here I'll tell you about Mara Foundation. And I'm your Eric Muta.
Yeah.
So I got to Mara Foundation. You get an office for like Moja, of Hamsini, I think. Office iko hivi, you get a table, ni meza, ina viti viwili. Sisi tukua tukua tatu, na iku na fires. So you had to get kitu kingine extra. Lakini, pale nikamkuta Eric, you know Eric,
problem solved.
Yes, I found Eric at Mara Foundation. Na pia nazisha startup yake, hiyo sasa, ile ambayo inafanya the...
Accounting system.
So, I'm sure the name, yes. And those three other companies, ziko pale. So you pay very little. We used to pay iyo, like moja na nusu, lakini tunapata meza na viti, kuna like water dispenser, kuna coffee tea, kuna machine ya printing, kuna machine ya photocopy, you pay 50 shillings ilikuwa, kufanya photocopy. Now, at that time, bring your point about my husband, he was a minister. Do you think that he couldn't afford to get me an office in the CBD? Overlooking the Indian Ocean. Yeah, but there I was sharing a table with two other people in a room ambayo other people who are new and strangers, and they also have their companies. He could have easily given me that startup life, the glamour startup life, but I didn't want to. It's only because I felt that we have to grow on our own. We have to create our own systems. If it's a struggle that will make us learn and establish something that can sustain, so be it. And it's so important to actually allow yourself that path and that journey and that struggle. Because eventually, there's some traits or some characteristics, so to say, that you will adapt in life, and it's only because you've gone through something. There's some behaviors you will get them only because you've gone through something. When you're so used to being given things, there's some aspects of you as an individual you probably wouldn't be able to acquire or to adapt. Things like resilience, things like hard work, those are the things, or determination, those are the things that you actually adapt or nobody was born as a hard worker. Come on, we were all born as babies, like crying, and like everything is done to us. But you, in your journey, in your life, you kind of adapt those traits and those skills. And so yes, today, like in terms of fundraising, we are close to $1 million, but it didn't come easy. We are here only because, again, it's those proposals, it's working hard. We have a huge team, not a huge team, but it's a sizable team. It gets the work done, and it's only because we allowed ourselves to go through that. Reach for Change came in December, 6 months later after we started. And Reach for Change was supporting an idea. Reach for Change is a very small part of our grants portfolio. We have other funders, so it's not only Reach for Change that is supporting us. The first grant they gave us was $25,000, which I'll forever credit and forever be grateful for, because it took us out of that space. We got an office. But any person getting that money would think, okay, let's just get a fancy office. We also got a very modest office, which we were sharing with another company. It was, I think, $500 a month. We could have gotten an office at $1,000 a month, right? We can afford it. It's only $12,000 a year, but we got an office at $500 a month. And then from there, we got some more funding and some more funding and some more funding, and here we are. But it doesn't happen overnight, and it wouldn't have happened if we got the first easy way out. Like if somebody just gave us like a $50,000 check in, let's say, June 2013, we wouldn't be able to grow our thick skin and grow the resilience that we have now. And I think the ingenuity for creativity and for hard work and for just achieving more. Because we think it's possible. We came from nothing, and here we are, so we can probably achieve so much more.
You know, I think Faraja huyu ni Faraja mtangazaji. Sio Faraja mjasiri ya mali au nini. For a moment, unajua sari ikiwa refu nana. I like that. But anyway, again, nauliwa muda si mrefu. We have to finish right now. Kabla sija kutimuliwa hapa na yengine. So, please.
Oh, she's raising her hand. No. Yeah. Such a long time.
Hi, jamani. Nimeambiwa last one. Lakini naomba kitu kimoja. One line. One-liners each.
Two of you,
one-liners each. Please, nakumba na wewe.
I'll keep it brief.
Keep it brief, please. Yeah, wait. Please make it one line.
Hi, guys. Hi. My name is Faraja, I'm a fresh graduate. Activist. Na diyo nimeanzisha initiative yangu ya kuwasaidia wanafunzi wanaoishi na kwenda shule katika mazingira magumu na hasa wanaoishi vijijini. Nina swali kwa Dr. Faraja. Ni very honored to be nikifollow the safari yake japo sikuweza kupata muda wa kuona face to face, so I was happy to be here. So swali langu ni kwamba kwa kuwa business yako ina customer wako ni wale ambao wana elimu au ni wale ambao tayari wako kwenye system au wana knowledge ya elimu. Swali langu ni kwamba kulingana na society yetu, tuna mtu kifeli form 4 definitely wanakuona like uko kilaza, wanaita kilaza, au qualify kuwa na elimu. Na tunajua kwamba kwenye vile vijijini kwetu ndipo hasa ambapo wanafunzi wengi wanapata shida na sometimes hawapati hata hiyo opportunity ya kuwa kwenye line ya kuwa hao wasomi au kuwa kwenye line hata ile ya kufeli form 4. Sasa kwa sababu customer wako, users wako ni wale wanaokuwa kwenye system ya elimu, je, Shule Direct ina any investment ya kuandaa wale watoto ambao wa vijijini kwa sababu watakuwa ni future users wa product yako. Una any investment ya kuwa support hao watoto or either in other way ambayo wanaweza wakapata at least a little bit kuwa kwenye line ya hao users. Kwa kuwa vijijini hakufiki technology, so even a little bit kwa kitabu or any hard copies, do you have any investment?
My lord, the shorter you tell them to talk, the longer they talk.
No, but technology for me, so some of that I have technology since I'm pretty good at doing a sim is a basic one. It's very easy to create it. It's a beginning to begin it. So you need to go to a busy form. Set your focus for secondary, and then you just done our new strategic plan, which in a improve their primary education. So keep to compose good things for primary schools.
Okay. We're mission the roof, sir. That's the
from the University of Dar es Salaam to a telecom engineer. Actually, the Swahili morning on a concept. I'm inspired by Shule. So far, Shule is more of delivering contents to students. We just give according to the syllabus and curriculum. So far, we will take contents for some of them. They have boot camps. Where students do stuff and all that. We should clearly integrate such things to the system so that people who are not doing such things can have access to see what other students are doing. Like, are you thinking of taking things from students to the system instead of just giving to students? Yeah. And also, one last thing, you don't know what's the price of the license. Yeah, that's what we're doing in the system.
Yes, so sasa hivi tuko tuna focus zaidi kwenye content yetu ili tuweze kuwa na content yote, yani mtu apate masomo yote 11 ambayo kwenye based on the curriculum, lakini we are opening it up to allow user generated content, which is what you're saying, like teachers or students to create content and share it on our platform. The learning management system for public for private school ni $1,500, for government school ni $800 per year. And then tuna inakuja una renew license kina teles teles fee.
So where?
Yes, we do think of that, and uzuri Coastal California training of tunishipine kama rambili za cyber security, na two of our developers were here, na we attend your training, and yes, our systems are very secure. You're welcome to hack them.
Welcome to hack them.
Yes.
Now guys,
you
are lucky we have a very generous Nali guest.
Yeah.
You be, you?
Yes, no, we shall listen, you learn.
Aye. Well,
but it's more or less from an investor point of view. So you talked a lot about how you it's really hard to get grants and you need a lot and you apply for grants a lot. Is it possible to take us through what checking average money investors mean? And I know sometimes you get a person, you don't necessarily intend for that person to be an investor, but you, there's, I don't know, there's a technical word that you say, it's an elevator speech. And I'm sure every startup or entrepreneur needs to develop that, because not every day you're going to have a board meeting full of people who are willing to hear your idea. So sometimes you have to meet someone on the street and this person has an interest in your idea, but you have to have insights. What is your speech like, and what technicalities, what information do you involve pitch to a person who you are trying to get investment from?
So, like, what's typical of an elevator pitch?
I mean, when you're looking for investments and you go to an investor, what are you keen to sell to that investor to make them buy into your idea? What are the key things that any entrepreneur should dig in and make sure that they know?
Right. Yes, so it depends. So, as I mentioned earlier, we have Shule Plus, which is a for-profit, and it's a pure company, and we invite equity investment and venture capital. So the pitch there is completely different. It's more focused on the financial returns. Any venture capitalist is looking for financial returns. So our pitch includes, obviously, the target market we are looking to serve, the number of the target market that we're looking to serve. So let's say it's 500,000 young people, a million young people, and what do we expect to get in return as financial returns? So let's say we expect to have 200,000 by 2018, we intend to break even in 5 years, and this is how we intend to break even. So that includes your marketing and communications plan. It's so important to be able to articulate your market, your vision, your target, your demographic that you're looking at, and the returns that you expect to get, and how soon you break even for a venture capitalist. Because I think for them, what really matters is when they will have their money back, and how, like, how much will they get back in terms of interest as well. So looking at exit strategies, but then that's at the later stage. But a typical pitch will just include, why should I invest in your idea? Why should I invest in your company? Convince me. And looking at Shule Direct, what we sell at Shule Direct is not money, is not profits, is not financial returns. What we pitch to a typical investor is the impact that we are getting. So we pitch two things. We pitch access, that we're providing access to this number of students, but out of that access, this is what really happens in their lives. They're able to improve their learning outcomes, they're able to improve their potential, and hopefully they'll be able to get to higher levels of education and succeed in life. So it depends really with how the objectives of your company, if it's a for-profit, if it's an NGO, or if it's a pure business, and each investor will be looking for something different. So if you go, for instance, to an impact investor, they're looking for, again, that story of change, your impact narration. How are you changing lives? And if at all, how many are you changing? And then the other guys, of course, they're all about money and getting their money back and taking a holiday somewhere nice.
Now, Yemani, I would say that's a wrap. Kumaliza hapa, it doesn't mean kwamba by the time we're done hapa, mwezi kuuliza maswali kupiga picha. Yes, you can. Faraja Kota Nyalandu, thank you for coming.
Thank you so much.
You've been a great guest.
Thank you
for sharing your stories. For a moment, I felt like she was the one doing my job and I was doing hers.
No.
Presenter and everything else. Now, kwa wengine wote, thank you very much kwa kuja hapa Startup Grind, a very beautiful event. Tunafanya kila mwezi. Our next event iko tarehe 25 February, please. Tarehe 28 rather, February. Should I tell them who we have? Our surprise. Should I tell them all?
Yeah.
We have Dr. Chris Smokey. I think a lot of you know him. And we know what February is a month of. Eh? A lot of people see it as a month of love. Lakini, some people are also looking at it as a very commercial month. A lot of people are making money. Kuna wengine naangalia so many other aspects. Lakini, tutaangalia on an entrepreneurship side, right? So, karibuni sana 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 tarehe 28. Thank you for coming. Startup Grind, we aim to give you ice, which is inspire, connect, and educate. Karibu sana sana sana. And t-shirts, jamani zinauza 15. Support the grind. We're still grinding on the hustle. This is our hustle, by the way. Umenyelewa. And pia tuna zawadi after every end of our event. Tunatoa zawadi.
Tusigeti
ni bana. Huh? Pictures. Yeah. Yes, he's small. You can see it's beautiful. You can custom make things for you. Come on, attack and customize it for you. See on buyer. So this is our gift kwa Faraja.
Thank you. Thank
you for
so
being
much.
A great, great, great inspiration.
Thank you.
Thank you.